السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Honorable Ulama, حفاظ الكرام, beloved elders, brothers in Islam, we praise and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his countless favors upon us. Alhamdulillah, this is the first Jumu'ah after the month of Ramadan, and we thank and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having bestowed upon us the ability to attain the month of Ramadan. May our actions in the month be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May it have been accepted and may it await us on the day when we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, multiplied again and again for us. The choice of topic today was a very easy decision. It was a very easy decision to decide what I should speak about today. And I would imagine that in most, if not all of the masajid, this would be the topic of discussion today. It is how to preserve and protect what we have attained in the month of Ramadan and take it forward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To sum it up, there's one comprehensive word described as being Jawami'ul Kalim, a very, very comprehensive word that encompasses what it is that we need to attain, we need to strive to attain now, especially that we have just finished the month of Ramadan. This is the concept known as Al-Istiqamah. Al-Istiqamah may be translated as consistency, may be translated as uprightness, may be translated as the straight and narrow. It is a very, very comprehensive word. So to define it correctly, we'll unpack this term today. What is istiqamah? And more importantly, how is it important to us? And how do we attain this quality of istiqamah so that we can preserve what we have attained during the month of Ramadan? We begin bi-ithnillahi ta'ala by saying that on the tongues and the lips of thousands upon thousands of ulama, al-istiqamah فوق ألف ألف كرامة. Istiqamah is so much greater than any miracle, or in fact miracles that we may want to experience. Generally, when we think of something great, when we think of something outstanding, شيء, something that is المخرك, that breaks العادة, something that breaks the norm, something that's out of the ordinary, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowing a miracle upon the hands of a person, perhaps a saint, perhaps a Nabi, perhaps bringing the dead back to life, showing us some sign or symbol that will increase our iman. This happens again and again in the Quran, in the hands of the Anbiya alayhim salatu wassalam, and even the awliya such as Sayyidatina Maryam alayhi salatu wassalam and others. This karamat or mu'jizat, miracles, certainly increases one's iman and provides one with a certain level of contentment. And it is for this reason that when Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam told or asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show him a sign, arini ayah, show me a sign, an ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, awalam tu'min, don't you have iman? He says, yes, but simply to set my heart at peace. In other words, to bring some contentment towards my heart. So certainly, miracles bring about contentment. It shows us, it reaffirms to us that indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists, indeed He is one, indeed He is all powerful. But there's something that exists that is beyond a miracle. There's something that Allah ta'ala can give us that is much better for us than a miracle. And this is the quality known as al-istiqamah. Qala imamuna al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam al-Nawawi, the author of many, many books, ones most famous to ourselves would be his compilation of the Futiha Hadith and the Riyadu Salihin. He would define istiqamah there and says that qala al-ulama, according to him, the ulama says, ma'na al-istiqamah, the meaning of this quality of istiqamah is luzum ta'ati Allah ta'ala. It is luzum, lazim. Lazim is when something is attached. You can't break it away from something else. It is luzum ta'ati Allah. It is to attach oneself to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To be attached to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, هي من جوامع الكلم. It is a very comprehensive term. وهي نظام الأمور. It means to set one's life in a particular pattern. It is to set one's matters in a particular pattern. To set an example about the effect that istiqamah may have, we can go from very elaborate examples and we can even use very small examples. To start off with perhaps a small example, if one wants to take 1,000,000 liters of water and you are given this 1,000,000 liters of water and you are told you need to use this water to create a hole in this piece of concrete. You have milliliters of water, you need to make a hole in a piece of concrete. You're not allowed to use any force, so no compressors, no machines that is going to burst the water out into the concrete, just simple water gravity in the concrete. How would one go about doing that? If you were to take the milliliters of water and set it loose in the concrete all in one go, you'd simply have wet concrete. No effect whatsoever. The concrete will simply dry, but it will remain as it was. If you even remove a grain of sand from that concrete, it would be a lot. Because the milliliters of water in one go is not going to have that effect. If, however, you concentrate that milliliters of water and allow it to drip onto one spot on the concrete, over a long period of time, what are you going to have? A hole in the concrete. This is the effect of doing something consistently. This is the effect of doing something perpetually, but without failing to come with one's consistent act. To show another example, if one was to be told to take the yellow pages or the, the phone book, this thick, and you were told, here, take this book and tear it up into pieces. If you were to take the entire book and attempt to tear that book, you wouldn't be able to do that. Not with your bare hands at least. But if you were to take each page and tear it one page at a time, or even a few pages at a time, you'd be able to tear that entire phone book. It will only just take a little bit longer. This is the effect of istiqamah. This is the miracle of istiqamah. Another example is something that we've just seen very recently. In the month of Ramadan, it is compulsory for each and every person who has enough food to feed himself and his family for the day of Eid and the night of Eid, and then has a little bit over to pay what is known as Zakatul Fitr. This is a small amount of money, an insignificant amount, 28 rands per person. It's really nothing. It did not put a hole in anybody's pocket. Anybody who qualifies to pay it, alhamdulillah, they've paid their Zakatul Fitr. And what was the effect? The effect was that parcels and parcels of food were distributed to the poor. The effect was pots and pots of food were made to be distributed to the poor. The effect was that so many poor people were fed on the day of Eid al-Fitr. This was the effect of what? Of each person just doing a little bit and contributing one little bit, and it made a massive difference. This is the miracle of istiqamah. Another more elaborate example is something that we've all heard of, perhaps when we were much younger. And this is the old folk tale of the tortoise and the hare. It's just a story, but it teaches us a very, very important lesson. Mr. Tortoise and Mr. Hare were friends. Mr. Hare, the rabbit in other words, the very special type of big rabbit. This Mr. Hare is bragging with Mr. Tortoise that he's so special because he's fast and he can bounce and he can do all sorts of things, as opposed to Mr. Tortoise, who's very slow and steady and he can't really get about. So they're having this debate with each other, and lo and behold, Mr. Tortoise challenges Mr. Hare to a race, and he says, look, I challenge you to a race, and I can tell you that I'm going to beat you in this race. And Mr. Hare was very upset about this. How dare you say that you can challenge me? You know, I'm driving a 8-cylinder engine here, and you driving not even 1 horsepower, you've got nothing. You're a little tortoise. And then they go about with a race. The gun goes off, and away goes Mr. Hare. Nowhere to be seen. Miles and miles away. He turns around, where's Mr. Tortoise? Nowhere to be found. He can't even see a trace of Mr. Tortoise. He's still there at the starting line. So what does Mr. Hare do? Mr. Hare decides, well, there's no fuss, there's no stress, there's no point in me rushing this way. All I have to do is take my time, relax, have it easy, eat some of this grass, graze here, there's some carrots there, nibble on the carrots and take a nice rest. Inshallah, Mr. Tortoise will come about, and then we will just go about our race again, and I will win him hands down. I'll beat him hands down. What happens? Mr. Hare is eating his grass, he's eating his carrots, he lays down and the cool wind hits his face under the sunlight and he falls asleep. He falls asleep and he remains sleeping without a worry, without a concern. And lo and behold, he wakes up, he looks around, he still doesn't see Mr. Tortoise, and then he takes a walk to the finishing line because he's clearly the winner. And as he approaches the finishing line, who does he see already on the other side? He sees Mr. Tortoise and he realizes that he has failed miserably. What is the moral of the story? The story teaches us that besides having the ability, besides having everything that it takes to get a particular objective done, it requires much more than mere ability and potential. It requires that effort be exerted, and that effort be exerted consistently, and that one cannot come out with bursts of energy doing a particular act and then grow tired and weary, or even decide to take it easy because, you know what, I can do it, that's easy for me. But then we end up not doing it, we end up not getting done. And this we experience in our lives all the time. I'm going to read the khatam of the Quran, inshallah. You know, I can read Quran, it's not that difficult for me. And then we promise ourselves that we're going to be doing it, inshallah. And then inshallah comes again, and inshallah comes around the third time, and eventually we find ourselves in the next month of Ramadan, and we haven't even gotten past Surah Al-Baqarah yet. This happens all the time in our work. This happens all the time with our families. Inshallah, I'm going to get some time. You know, when I have time, I'm going to work on this. When I have time, I'm going to work on that. When I have time, Allahu Akbar wa lillahi alhamd. When is the time going to come unless we make that time? When we have consistency, my beloved elders and brothers in Islam, we can cure what I like to call the Eno effect. We must be very, very, very careful of becoming Eno Muslims. When we get that burst of hidayah and we see the light, the month of Ramadan comes and we feel so inspired and Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, and we feel that now I'm going to make a firm intention, I'm going to make Taraweeh, I'm going to read the juz of the Quran every day, I'm going to make Azkar, I'm going to make Salah 5 times a day in the Masjid, I'm going to make sure that I'm staying away from everything that is haram, and I'm doing much, much more ibadah than usual. And that's why the Masjid is full on the first night, and full on the second night, and empty on the third night, and empty here on the fourth night, and empty here on the fifth night, and it gets worse and worse. Until comes the 27th night and Allahu Akbar, I need to get that burst of inspiration again. And then the Masjid is all of a sudden full again. This is what you call the Eno effect. You know when you take Eno's, effervescence, you throw it into some water, and what happens? For the first few moments it bubbles. So much so that the bubbles might even come over the edge of the glass. But give it a few moments and what does it look like again? Nothing but water. Nothing to show for it. Whereas the believer, the Muslim is constantly upright. The Muslim doesn't deviate from his consistency. This is the miracle of istiqamah. And when we can manage to do this, we won't be like Enos and bubble all vigorously, and then once the bubbling is gone, we have nothing to show for it. We need to really take our time and take what we can manage to be consistent with. And in this, inshallah, we will attain great feats in our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This comes from the teaching of our beloved messenger Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this story is now no longer just a story. This comes in an authentic hadith narrated by Imam Muslim and Imam al-Bukhari rahimahum Allah ta'ala. The hadith is muttafaqun alayh. It is narrated by Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. She said that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam came one day, and with her was a woman. And this woman, she was mentioning all her good deeds, that she's performing so many raka'at of salah at night and she doesn't sleep, etc. And another narration comes similar to this one, that a person is also restricting himself to no sleep and performing all sorts of ibadah throughout the night. What did the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam say to these people? Did he say, well done, mashallah, you know, try to do even more? Did he say to these people, you know, excellent, excellent, may everybody follow your example? Or did he say to these people, you know, what you are doing is something that we should all strive for? Wallahi, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said nothing of the sort. In fact, he said to them, Mah, hold it, hold it. Alaykum min al-a'mali ma tutiqoon. Upon you, meaning you should only do those actions which you are able to do. This is a strange statement, because the reason the person is mentioning what they were doing is because they were able to do it. Clearly they stayed awake the night and they managed to perform those raka'at of salah, and yet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to them, you should only do that which you are able to do. So what we read into that is, you should only do what you are able to do consistently, what you are able to keep up with. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam said, you should do those actions that you are able to do, fawallahi, for verily by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he takes a qasam, inna Allah la yamallu hatta tamallu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not turn away from you until you turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, simply, that if we turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a'mal, and we now stand for 20 rak'ahs of Taraweeh every single night. And we stand and we perform Salat al-Tahajjud for a certain number of rak'ahs. And we read Qur'an, certain amount of pages or ajza, whatever the case might be. And we make adhkar. And then all of a sudden, we stop. Then essentially what we have done is, we have turned away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might just turn His rahmah away from us. Then, further on in this narration, Aisha radiallahu anha reports that the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, they wouldn't do actions like this. No. إِذَا عَمِلُوا When they used to act amalan, any act, أَثْبَتُوهُ They would remain consistent on that act. They would remain perpetual on that act. So let's say, for example, they decided to make 4 raka'at of tahajjud. Only 4 raka'at and nothing more. For example, that would mean that they would make sure that they make that 4 raka'at every single night. Let's say, for example, they would read a half a page of the Qur'an. Then they would read that half a page every single day. But they would not leave off that action. And in another narration from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also authentic, the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam mentions that أَحَبُّ الْعَمَلِ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَا دَاوَمَ عَلَيْهِ صَاحِبُهُ وَإِنْ قَلَّ The most beloved actions to Allah, رَبُّ الْعِزَّةِ وَالْجَلَالِ are those actions which the person doing the action does perpetually, even if it be a little. My beloved elders and brothers in Islam, what this means is that for myself to decide today that I'm not just going to read a section of the Quran, one hizb, or one maqra, or one quarter, or one juz. No, I'm going to read 3-4 ajaza of the Quran. When I'm done there, I'm done with life itself. Because mukh can't do anything anymore, can't stand up, I need to go and sleep, I need to go and spend the night resting. And then I leave that Quran for the next few months until some miracle happens again and I feel the raghbah, I feel the energy to read some more. This is not the most beloved action to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But rather the other person who opens up that Qur'an and reads but one ayah or one short chapter or one quarter of a page or one hizb or one makra or whatever portion he or she may want to read but does so consistently, perhaps every day, perhaps every 2 days, perhaps every 3 days, that person's actions are more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than my 3-4 ajaza that I'm reading today. Or in fact, my entire khatam that I read in 1 month that I never ever repeat or that I never ever carry out with for the rest of the year. This is the miracle of istiqamah. We can attain what we've attained in the month of Ramadan. What did we do in the month of Ramadan? We fasted every day. That was the key to our spiritual high. We performed salah consistently. That was the key to our spiritual high. We performed taraweeh consistently. That was the key to our spiritual high. We were charitable. We stayed away from haram consistently. That is the key to our spiritual high. There is nothing other than the realm of the unseen that is different in the month of Ramadan as opposed to other times. In the realm of the unseen, yes, certain things are taking place. But in the realm of the real world, whatever we did in that month, we can do outside of the month of Ramadan. Now the question is, how do we carry on with this particular concept and implement it in our lives? I have a simple formula that I wish to share with each and every one of you. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam institutionalized for us the sunnah. And the sunnah teaches us how to carry about our lives. And if we look at the sunnah, we will see that one of the things Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was really good at was managing time. That he would have time to mend his own clothing, he would have time to spend time with his family, he would have time for ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a long, long period of time. He would have time for the people in the community, and he would have time for himself as well. This was our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if we look at how he managed this time, one thing stands out that applies to each and every one of us as well. We have been given a forced method of istiqamah in our lives. And that is nothing else but our 5 daily salahs. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا Salah has been fixed at prescribed times for the believers. All we need to do, and we need to try this, and it needs to be something that we leave here today with, and we have to actually make an intention. I'm going to try this for a few days inshallah, and if it works out, I'm going to implement it for the rest of my life, and I'm going to encourage others as well. All we need to do is design our days around our salahs. We need to plan exactly what it is that we want to do and then design that around our salahs. For example, after Salatul Fajr, I'm going to recite Surah Yasin or a particular method of adhkar, a particular system of dhikr. Whether that be 100 La ilaha illallah, 100 salawat, 100 istighfar, whatever the case might be. But I'm going to do one specific act of ibadah after Salatul Fajr every single day. That's all. If you're going to make it into proportions that you can't bear, it's not even going to work on the first day. Just something that you can manage to do consistently. After Salatul Dhuhr, I'm going to read a half a page of the Quran. So before I get up, after I say Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, before I get up from my place of salah, I'm going to read a half a page of the Quran. For example, doesn't have to be what I'm saying, it can be any other act of ibadah. I'm going to read a half a page of ilms. I'm going to have a book of knowledge, perhaps a book of fiqh, perhaps a book of hadith, and I'm going to read that and I'm going to implement whatever knowledge it has there. That's it. I'm not going to do any more because then I won't be able to have istiqamah. After Salatul Asr, I'm going to make dhikr. Whatever the dhikr might be, perhaps salawat, perhaps istighfar, perhaps I'm going to read some sunan, du'as of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but only for 5 minutes, for 10 minutes, whatever I can manage. After Salatul Maghrib, I'm going to do something. After Salatul Isha, I'm going to do something. And that's it. No more than 5 to 10 minutes after each waqt. Or if we can bear a little bit more than that, then we do a little bit more than that. And we do this for a period of 1 week or 1 month. And once we get used to this, now we continue. And we add a little bit more. Not much more, just a little bit more. That way, we're going to perform salah anyways. All we have to do is we have to make sure we don't stand up until we do that particular act of ibadah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all that quality of istiqamah, to be uprighteous consistently inshallah. There was many more verses and ayat and ahadith that I wish to have quoted, but my time is up. So I would leave us with this quote of the Quran inshallah, and allow us to take this home with us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهُ. Indeed those who say Allah is our Lord. But they don't just leave it at that. They don't just speak. ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا. And then they have this quality of istiqamah. They remain consistent upon that. They act according to that. فَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. When they die, the angels will descend upon them. The angels who will come to take their ruh will descend upon them. أَلَّا تَخَافُوا. And the angels will say to them, do not fear. In other words, do not fear for what is about to happen, because you have nothing to fear of what is about to happen. وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. And don't be sad. Don't be sad about that which you leave behind, because that which you leave behind is good for you. وَأَبْشِرُوا. And glad tidings to you of what? بِالْجَنَّةِ. Of the gardens which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared. أَلَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوعَدُونَ. Which you have been promised. نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاؤُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. We were your guardians and protectors in this dunya, in this low life. وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. And we will also be your friends in the akhirah. وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ. And since you had belief and you had perpetual consistency on that belief, for you in Jannah is whatever your nafs desires. Because there you're allowed to have as much nafsi desires as you want. وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَدَّعُونَ. And for you in Jannah is exactly what you ask for. نُزُلًا مِّنْ غَفُورِ الرَّحِيمِ. This will be your entertainment from the most forgiving, the most merciful. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ سُبْحَانَهُ وَبِحَمْدِهِ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَبِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ